All right, the next speaker is Dr. David Shrump, who is at the NIH, where he's the head of, or co-chief, I guess, of the thoracic and GI oncology branch. He actually is also kind of comes from the Northeast, I guess. He went to the University of Connecticut Medical School and went to some really prestigious institutions at the University of Chicago, which is a huge surgical institution for general surgery residency, and then spent 3 years doing a human immunology research fellowship at Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center, and then basically finished his thoracic surgery residency at University of Michigan, which is the preemptive kind of thoracic surgery training program from the beginning. I imagine he's a member of the Alexander Society and all that kind of stuff. So then he went to MD Anderson. He ended up at the NIH, where he's done a lot of good work in doing clinical trials and building a program that Steve Rosenberg would be proud of. In fact, he's starting to look like Steve Rosenberg a lot. So and believe me, I saw Steve Rosenberg a lot when I was there, so I know. So he's going to talk about targeting the epigenome in malignant pleural mesothelioma, which some of you may not know a lot about, but I'm sure of it. By the end of the day, you'll know everything you need to know. Dr. Shrump.
First of all, I'd like to thank the organizing committee for the privilege of participating in this symposium. It's been really very fascinating. I arrived at the NCI actually 20 years ago. It's hard to believe, but I was operating on mesothelioma patients as a legacy to Michele Carbone and Harvey Pass. And I figured if I was operating on these patients, then I might as well try to learn something about the disease. And so we now have actually a very active program. I mean, I think in combination with the medical oncologists, we're seeing over 100 patients a year. Everybody that is enrolled on clinical trials is providing blood, tissue. We're establishing cell lines, patient-derived xenografts, and their travel and care is provided free of charge because of our taxes. I have no disclosures. Basically, what I'm going to briefly do is talk about some epigenetic mechanisms of gene expression in normal and malignant cells as they're relevant to the talk here, provide some evidence of clinically relevant epigenetic alterations in mesothelioma, and for those who are involved in this field, it may seem like deja vu all over again. I'll talk briefly about some of the strategies we've used to model early epigenetic events in mesothelioma, and then some epigenetic strategies that we've embarked on for mesothelioma therapy. Well, epigenetic regulation of gene expression is occurring by four major mechanisms, that being DNA methylation mediated by DNA methyltransferases, or DNMTs. There are a variety of post-transcriptional modifications of core histone proteins that either compact or relax chromatin. There are ATP-dependent chromatin remodeling complexes, and more recently, long non-coding RNAs have emerged as critical mediators of epigenetic gene expression, because they function as scaffolds to recruit DNA methylation machinery to chromatin. I need to just briefly mention polycomb proteins because this is going to be critical and relevant for something later on in the talk. I've noticed that these maintain pluripotency by reversibly silencing genes that are involved in mediating differentiation. The initiation complex, polycomb repressive complex 2, or PRC2, which is composed of a variety of subunits including EED, EZH2, and SUSY12, mediates a trimethylation of a residue on histone 3, which is a lysine 27 or H3K27. This repressive mark is then identified or recognized by a maintenance polycomb complex, PRC1, which then mediates ubiquitination of another histone residue on histone H2A, this being H2A lysine 119. I've noticed that BAP1, which was discussed earlier in this symposium, actually reverses this ubiquitination mark, so in essence tends to mitigate the repressive activity of this polycomb complex. There are multiple core components of the PRC2 as well as PRC1 that are upregulated in cancer cells of a variety of histologies. And it's been shown that tumor suppressor genes, which are frequently targeted for DNA methylation in a variety of human cancers, are stem cell polycomb targets. In terms of the introduction, are just the alterations that are occurring at the chromatin level with regard to malignant transformation. In normal cells, there are vast regions of the DNA that are in a closed, hypermethylated, compact, or heterochromatin state, which is silenced. The tumor suppressor genes are in a relaxed or euchromatic state, exhibiting no or very little levels of DNA methylation. During malignant transformation, there's genomic DNA demethylation that leads to upregulation of endogenous retroviruses, as well as upregulation of cancer germline or cancer testis genes. These are highly restricted genes that are only expressed in the germline that actually encode a variety of very attractive targets for cancer immunotherapy, including NY-ESO-1 and MAGE-3. During this context of genomic DNA demethylation, there is site-specific hypermethylation, and the polycomb complexes that I've also talked about actually mediate aberrant silencing of tumor suppressors. So this so-called DNA methylation paradox actually provides the rationale for epigenetic therapy for cancer. Well, there are a variety of genetic alterations that are occurring in mesothelioma. We heard about BAP1 mutations, which are occurring in quite a significant amount of sporadic and virtually all of the familial cancer mesos. There's allelic loss or methylation of INC4A and ARF, which basically encode components of the RB and P53 tumor suppressor pathway. And there are inactivating mechanisms or mutations that are targeting the HIPPO tumor suppressor pathway. But this was shown on a previous slide. What you see is there it's still, despite these mutations, there's a relatively low limit of tumor mutational burden, which suggests that epigenetic events may be really important drivers in malignant pleural mesothelioma. There's evidence, once again, of epigenetic alterations that are occurring in frequent DNA hypermethylation and silencing of tumor suppressors. The extent of this DNA methylation may actually reflect copy number alterations as well as asbestos exposure. There's upregulation of EZH2 and other polycomb components and polycomb-mediated silencing of tumor suppressors with or without DNA methylation. And the timing and the clinical relevance of these epigenetic alterations has really not been firmly established. These are some data from our own lab, basically looking at quantitative RT-PCR analysis of a variety of epigenetic writers following a fairly extensive microarray analysis. And what I'm just depicting here in the red are very consistent upregulation of DNA methyltransferases, particularly DNMT1, as well as this EZH2, which is a core component of the polycomb repressive complex 2. We looked at a large number of histone deacetylases and other writers that I'm not going to include on the slide, but of note was HDAC9 was consistently elevated across all of our tumor lines. When we actually queried the TCA database recently, what we were intrigued to see is that there was a survival impact of all of the DNA methyltransferases, with overexpression correlating with a significantly worse survival in mesothelioma. Similarly, when we looked at core components of polycomb repressive complex 2, we saw, once again, significantly worse core survivals with overexpression of EED and SUSY12, but not EED, which actually is a core component that actually is required to maintain stability of the PRC2 complex. We've developed an in vitro model system with which to examine some of the epigenetic alterations, specifically trying to look at the timing and sequence of these. I'm not going to go through all of the data for time constraints, but we use either an LP9 cells, which were discussed in the last talk, or primary normal mesothelial cells. And what we observed with a 10-day exposure using asbestos concentrations that were 2 to 5-fold lower than what has been previously used in the literature, was there was a dose-dependent upregulation of DNMT1, which once again was consistently observed in our cell line panel, and we saw an upregulation of EZH2, once again seen on the previous slide. This coincided with downregulation of a tumor suppressor, RAS-F1A, which is frequently inactivated in mesothelioma, and we went on to demonstrate through CHIP as well as a variety of other techniques that this is due to DNA hypermethylation at the promoter as well as recruitment of polycomb repressive complexes. We also observed downregulation of both P16 and P14, indicating inactivation of this locus, which is frequently targeted for deletion in mesothelioma. And we were intrigued by the fact that this was occurring by polycomb-mediated mechanisms without DNA hypermethylation. So basically what this model is showing us is that asbestos is mediating very rapid inactivation of RAS-F1A as well as P16 and P14. And repression of these genes, but not others that have been frequently silenced in mesotheliomas, suggests a very strong selective pressure to silence HIPPO as well as RB and P53 tumor suppressor pathways. I think that this model shows, confirms the relevance of the DNA methyltransferases as well as polycomb repressive complexes as therapeutic targets in mesothelioma. So shifting gears, I'd like to just talk briefly about some strategies that we've used to target DNA methyltransferase expression. These are the DNMT inhibitors. Of note, these are analogs of cytidine. Only azacitidine and decitabine are the only two approved DNA demethylating agents. SGI-110 is in clinical trial and is a derivative of decitabine. These actually function by incorporating into DNA. They trap the DNA methyltransferases and lead to rapid depletion, primarily of DNMT1 and to a lesser extent DNMT3B. Of note is that these agents have extremely short half-lives and poor oral bioavailability, so they have to be administered as either subcutaneous or intravenous injections. Oral azacitidine has been evaluated in clinical trials. Oral decitabine is not commercially available. Well, trying to target DNA methyltransferases in mesothelioma is not a novel concept. Dr. Vogelzang in 1997 reported a 17% response rate, including one complete response in 41 mesothelioma patients receiving prolonged administration of dihydroazacitidine. We published a phase one study in 2005 in which we observed no objective responses in 35 patients with thoracic cancers, including six mesotheliomas, following a 72-hour decitabine infusion. However, several patients actually had extensive stabilization of disease. What we did observe in molecular analysis was induction of NY-ESO-1, MAGE-3 or P16 in about 40% of the patients that were included on this trial, suggesting that there really was a biochemical or pharmacodynamic effect, and that there was a progressive increase in cancer testis antigen expression over time, demonstrating the fact that we need chronic exposures of epigenetic agents for them to be optimal. And I think this trial established proof of concept regarding the use of epigenetic modulation of gene expression in thoracic cancers. We have always advocated in all of the manuscripts that we've published in terms of mechanisms of cancer testis antigen induction that these really should be combined with immunotherapy regimens. And this was from a paper that we published, I think, in 2005, in which we demonstrated that sequential administration of intravenous decitabine followed by adoptive transfer of a murine CTL targeting an antigen that we could upregulate could mediate complete regression of metastatic disease in an immunocompetent murine model. And I think this is one of the first, if not the first, demonstrations of the combination of epigenetic regimens with adoptive therapies. Well, it's also very clear now that the effects of DNA demethylating agents on anti-tumor immunity are highly pleiotropic. These agents not only upregulate cancer germline genes, resulting in upregulation of tumor antigens such as NY-ESO-1 and MAGE, but they also activate endogenous retroviral sequences, and through a process referred to as viral mimicry, lead to upregulation of gamma interferon and enhanced immunogenicity of the tumors. On the other hand, these agents also upregulate PD-L1, which would tend to induce tolerance, but this can be abrogated through combined PD-L1 or PD-1 blockade. These agents are also modulating through very complex mechanisms the tumor microenvironment as well as systemic anti-tumor immunity. And I think that this is going to be very important to keep this in mind as we start to really develop epigenetic regimens for cancer. Well, one of the issues related to these agents is the poor oral bioavailability, short half-life, and toxicities related to the infusion mechanisms. And this is all related to expression of cytidine deaminase, which is an enzyme which is ubiquitously expressed in the body that rapidly inactivates decitabine. This can be actually overcome by an agent referred to as tetrahydrouridine, which has been administered to several thousand cancer patients with negligible toxicity. These are from some experiments that have been done basically demonstrating that the use of tetrahydrouridine can significantly enhance decitabine-mediated gene activation, gamma interferon release. It can inhibit expansion of myeloid-derived tumor suppressors. And of note here is that it leads to survival or cures of about 40% of animals with lethal injections of a highly metastatic lung cancer. And these animals are protected from, survive a subsequent rechallenge with these tumor cells. This has led actually into some preclinical studies that have now gone on to a phase one study in sickle cell disease, in which oral administration of tetrahydrouridine markedly enhances the bioavailability as well as the half-life of oral decitabine. So now this is a completely oral regimen. This is leading to downregulation of DNMT1, hypomethylation of DNA, and upregulation of fetal hemoglobin, indicative of a systemic hypomethylating effect, all without any significant toxicities. And it's on the basis of these data that we actually have two clinical trials now using this combination with immune checkpoint inhibitors at the NCI. One is a randomized phase two study of this oral regimen with nivolumab versus nivolumab alone as second line therapy for lung cancer. And then we have a dose escalation study using this oral regimen with pembrolizumab as first line therapy for non-small cell lung cancer. There's extensive analysis of pharmacodynamic endpoints involved in both of these clinical trials. This, I think, if we see some signal of activity and efficacy, could easily be translated to therapy for mesothelioma. We've already published that decitabine can upregulate tumor antigens and facilitate their recognition by CTL. We have data from the lab demonstrating that there is a heterogeneous upregulation of endogenous retroviruses by these mechanisms, and that azacitidine has been shown in preclinical models to enhance checkpoint inhibitor efficacy, as shown here, where the combination of azacitidine and anti-CTLA-4 led to an 80% response rate in immunocompetent animals compared to a response rate of 0 versus 30%. And I think that this would be a strong rationale to combine this oral regimen with pembrolizumab, given the efficacy of pembrolizumab in studies to date. Very briefly, what I'd like to talk about are some strategies to target EZH2. I'm not going to go through all of these data, but these data from our lab were the first demonstration that EZH2 and other components of PRC2 are upregulated in mesothelioma, and that PRC2 is a targetable or druggable target in mesothelioma, as shown here by these curves of activity in mesoxenografts. PRC2 is overexpressed in a wide variety of cancers, both solid as well as hematologic, and this has led to a fairly significant activity by pharma to try to target the PRC2 complex that has multiple components. The data that we used, what we used for our mesothelioma manuscript, was DZ-NEP, which basically depletes these proteins, preventing formation of this complex. This DZ-NEP is not under clinical development at this point. EPZ is an epizyme or tazemetostat, which has recently been in clinical trial. GSK-126 is actually no longer under clinical development, unfortunately. But there are also other strategies, such as one by Novartis, which is actually blocking the protein-protein interactions between EED and other core components. There are ways that we can actually try to exploit BAP1 mutation status for mesothelioma. Once again, I mentioned that BAP1 tends to mitigate the repressive activity of the PRC2 complex. It's been demonstrated that BAP1 mutations lead to significant upregulation of EZH2 and increased epigenetic silencing of tumor suppressors. Parenthetically, they appear to sensitize mesotheliomas to EZH2 inhibitors, as demonstrated in these two xenograft experiments, showing significant anti-tumor effects in a tumor with mutant BAP1 as opposed to no particular activity or no significant activity in BAP1 wild-type tumors. And this has led to a phase two multicenter study, which the first component was PK analysis, followed by a second component, which was a response evaluation in mesothelioma patients with mutant BAP1. This is currently active, but no longer accruing since it's met its accrual ceiling. In our hands, we've had very limited luck trying to get any of these agents for clinical trial, and they don't appear to be particularly active, at least in our hands, in our tissue cultures, despite what we're seeing in the controls. So we looked for other alternatives to try to indirectly target the PRC2 complex. We had previously published that an anti-tumor agent referred to as mithromycin could markedly alter stem cell signaling and mediate dramatic tumor regressions in xenografts of esophageal cancer as well as lung cancer. And we were intrigued by these series of experiments in which we saw that just a 24-hour exposure to mithromycin significantly inhibited growth of mesothelioma cells in vitro and markedly inhibited growth of mesothelioma xenografts in a dose-dependent manner. We went on, I'm not going to bore you with all of this data here, but this is through depletion of specificity protein 1, which is a ubiquitous transcription factor, as well as upregulation of P53, which in mesothelioma is retained in over 70% of the tumors. These are the biochemical confirmatory experiments. Notice that mithromycin is also depleting a variety of other components of PRC2. This led to a phase two clinical trial in which 12 patients were treated, including six mesothelioma patients. There are 20 cycles that were administered in these patients. All were evaluable for toxicities. We observed, however, no objective responses in seven evaluable patients. What was interesting is that we saw no myelosuppression, bleeding, or CNS toxicities that had been widely described when this drug was used in the 60s and the 70s. And we think it's because the drug that we had commissioned to be produced for these clinical trials was a more pure grade than what had been used previously. What was of concern, though, is that eight patients experienced asymptomatic dose-limiting transaminitis. It was very reproducible when it occurred. Generally, by about day three in those patients that developed the transaminitis, we'd see an uptick, and then by day four, they were in where we would have to hold the drug. Biopsies of the liver demonstrated hepatocellular death. Once again, when we stopped the drug, the transaminitis reversed. There had been no drug levels ever measured when this drug had been used in the 60s and the 70s because assays had not been developed at that time. We developed an assay at the NCI to measure this, and we were intrigued by the fact that the toxicities that were seen in the patients that did and did not have the liver toxicities could not be attributable to differences in the drug level. Because the differences were so striking, however, we then went on to use a CLIA-certified assay looking at about 2,500 polymorphisms in 230 genes regulating metabolism and transport of drugs. And what we observed was the hepatotoxicity actually correlated in a significant manner with the expression of two pump proteins that regulate bile flow. The results were then confirmed using hepatocytes from warm autopsies. From the pharmacokinetic data, we were able to actually then model dosing that might have to be administered over a 24-hour period that could actually recapitulate the exposures that we were using in the animals in which we saw such profound anti-tumor activity. These are the pharmacokinetic levels for the 6-hour infusion that we were seeing. This is the same dose administered over 24 hours. And we believe that if we can administer 50 micrograms as opposed to 25 micrograms over a 24-hour period, we'll be in the peak levels and sustained levels of this exposure here that is mimicking the preclinical toxicity experiments. So this has led to a phase 1-2 evaluation of mithromycin. The phase 1 is a dose-escalating component to just determine the pharmacokinetics and the toxicities and the maximum tolerated dose of this 24-hour infusion administered every 2 weeks. And the phase 2 component will be a standard phase 2 objective response rate. And patients here are being selected on the basis of germline genotyping. So in conclusion, I think mesotheliomas exhibit frequent epigenetic alterations, some of which are actually potentially actionable at this point. Epigenetic agents are going to require prolonged exposures and are best used in combinatorial regimens. These agents not only are targeting the tumor cells, but are also modulating the microenvironment and systemic anti-tumor immunity, sometimes with opposing effects. BAP1 mutations appear to alter epigenetic profiles. They inhibit DNA repair, sensitizing mesothelioma cells to EZH2 inhibitors. And what I didn't demonstrate here are some sensitization to PARP inhibitors. Mithromycin may be an attractive agent for mesothelioma. I think the precision medicine and pharmacokinetic simulations may enhance the efficacy of these epigenetic regimens moving forward. And I think what I've tried to demonstrate that it's a very long and bumpy road from the bench to the bedside. Thank you.